In 1876, General Custer, along with 262 men, were killed here at the Little Bighorn. A shocked American government responded by pouring troops into the disputed territory. Indian resistance crumbled almost immediately. By spring the following year, Crazy Horse had been forced to surrender in order to feed the starving people under his care. But within a few months of his return, he was killed on a reservation for resisting arrest. Meanwhile, Sitting Bull would see out his days in this cabin after agreeing to live under house arrest on a reservation. With their resistance in tatters, the tribes fell under the influence of a new religion called the Ghost Dance.
The whole crux of the Ghost Dance was to dance and to pray to our ancestors. And that would help bring the world back to the way it was before white people came. All the buffalo would come back, the dead relatives would live again. And I mean, after, you know, decades of fighting and now being on reservations, living on starvation rations, being under the control of whites, when that kind of hope is dangled, people latch down to it.
When the authorities heard that some of the tribes were praying to bring back the world the way it was, they panicked. Their first knee-jerk response was to arrest Sitting Bull, but it was botched and he was killed. With the great chief dead, many people fled the reservations in terror.
On December the 28th, 1890, a detachment of the 7th Cavalry, the same regiment that had fought under Custer at Little Bighorn, was sent to bring in a chief called Bigfoot and his followers. When they found them, Bigfoot had contracted pneumonia and his followers were in need of food and shelter. So the cavalry set about escorting the 120 men and 230 women and children in the party back to the reservation lands. Halfway home, they stopped and made camp here at Wounded Knee.
If Custer's last stand is a tale of romance and glory for both sides, Wounded Knee is essentially a tale of murder.
It was snowing and the tribes camped overnight in this hollow. They were surrounded by riflemen and by Hotchkiss guns, deadly repeating cannon. In the morning, Colonel James Forsyth, a contemporary of Custer's, ordered a weapons search.
Several searches were done, and the commander apparently was not satisfied with the amount of weapons that were found. He thought that there were more, so he became nervous. And then the soldiers got more and more aggressive, more and more assertive, and women were crying out to their men who were standing off to one side because the men had been gathered by the commander.
No one's quite sure what happened next, but one thing is clear. Someone somewhere fired a gun, and all hell broke loose.
This was a slaughter. The cannons fired 2 pounds of shell and shrapnel at the rate of 50 rounds per minute and mowed down everything in their path, whether it was Lakota or fellow American soldiers. At the same time, every rifleman had a clear target and emptied round after round into the campsite. The killing went on into the afternoon as the soldiers pursued and murdered the fleeing men, women and children over several miles.
These are photographs of the aftermath of the massacre. Over 200 Lakota Sioux men, women and children lay dead. The army also killed 25 of their own soldiers and wounded a further 39. This photograph of Chief Bigfoot's frozen corpse came to symbolize the tragedy of that day.
A fierce blizzard forced the cavalry to evacuate the site with the wounded. 3 days later, they came back to bury the dead. Most of the bodies were piled into a mass grave, which now forms the centerpiece for this cemetery.
No one was convicted of any charges following Wounded Knee. In fact, the government issued a record number of congressional medals to the men involved.
At the time, it wasn't the Lakota who got the sympathy, it was the soldiers. This came from the Aberdeen Pioneer, which was a local South Dakota newspaper. Our only safety depends upon the total extermination of the Indians. Having wronged them for centuries, we'd better, in order to protect our civilization, follow it up by one more wrong and wipe these untamed and untamable creatures from the face of the earth. Otherwise, we may expect future years to be as full of trouble with the Redskins as those have been in the past. And that was written by Frank L. Boehm, who went on to write The Wizard of Oz.
The pain of this tragedy runs deep. John goes in center, is Nglala Sioux spokesman.
I'd say it's still very much a crime scene because of the atrocities. You know, I guess people call them war crimes, but there was no war going on, so it definitely was a crime, you know, I would say.
John is part of the Tribal Preservation Office, and he explained how hard it's been for Native people here to move forward.
We've been living, ever since it happened, with a lot of sorrow and anger. So I'm looking for a path from victimhood to being victors. But I come from a generation where it was not good to be an Indian. But I see this generation really sort of like prospering from all these events that have happened, but are learning to be free thinkers. So that's why hopefully that we can tap into is understand who we are again to really regain that power and spirit. And I do see it happening with the youth.
John's also clear that the tribes will never give up their claim on the land or forget what it means to them.
Well, the land is our identity. It's our mother. I mean, these are things that we inherently have understood for time immemorial. We are from the earth. We not only just live off the land, but we live with the land. We're part of it.
And so the fight to tell their side of the story goes on. This statue is that fight writ large across the landscape of South Dakota. This is a memorial to Crazy Horse, carved out of a mountain in the Black Hills. Its roots lay in a monumental snub.
An Oglala Lakota chief and elder, Henry Standing Bear, wanted to make a statement about his people and the importance of their culture. So he asked whether the face of their most famous warrior, Crazy Horse, could be added to the faces on Mount Rushmore. When he was turned down, he decided to build his own tribute.
Imagined on horseback by the sculptor Korchalk Julkowski, this is how the finished statue will look. When completed, it will measure over 600 feet long and stand over 500 feet high. This is being built with private donations and with funds raised through the Crazy Horse Memorial Foundation. The site's also home to the Indian Museum of North America and the Indian University of North America. The memorial's director of media, Lauren Ebert, explains the philosophy behind it all.
Why? What's it all for? Why is it so important?
You know, education is important, and educating a people and making sure that their culture and history lives on is the real value here.
What does that face say to you?
Crazy Horse was Oglala Lakota. I happen to also be Oglala Lakota, and I'm proud to have that connection to the mountain and to the people.
When I was growing up, the West was all about cowboys, not Indians. Maybe that's because their Wild West story doesn't make us feel that good about ourselves.